They knew exactly what was happening to them. And I knew exactly what was happening to us. They're killing us. We weren't going to be Indians anymore. We didn't have a neighborhood. Nothing.
Gabriel of Urantia is a spiritual leader, musician, author, visionary, and co-founder of Global Community Communications Alliance, a multifaceted world spiritual community and eco-village. Conversations with Activists to Inspire Global Change provides a forum for activists to voice their concern for humanitarian issues. Russell Means is an activist for the rights of American Indians. He has notable careers in politics, acting, and music. This is part one of a four-part interview based on his autobiography, Where White Men Fear to Tread.
Let me be a free man, free to travel, free to stop, free to trade where I choose, free to choose my own teachers, free to follow the religion of my fathers, free to talk, think, and act for myself.
Chief, we're here today with Russell Means. And Russell Means is an Oglala Lakota, born in 1939 in the Pine Ridge Reservation near the Black Hills in South Dakota. Russell was the first national director of the American Indian Movement and has fought most of his adult life for the rights of the Indian people. His autobiography, Where White Men Fear to Tread, tells his story very beautifully. You call part one the Genesis, starting with your birth in 1939 through 1964. Would you like to talk about those first years?
Well, the first 5 years of my life was largely spent on my mother's reservation. We are a matriarchal society, so the husband usually goes where the wife is from. But I was born on Pine Ridge, my father's reservation, because the Bureau of Indian Affairs would only allow you to be an Indian if you were born on your father's reservation, at least as far as the Lakota people were concerned. Now understand, we're matriarchal, so that's a way of genocide. It's a policy of genocide. My two younger brothers, twin brothers, they were born on my, they're 7 years younger than I. And yet they were 29 years old before they were enrolled. And that was after, because of AIM, the American Indian Movement, after we got the right for Indian people to be sovereign and to make their own decisions on who their citizens are, not the government of the United States of America. So my younger brothers were not considered Indians for 29 years of their life. Then they finally got enrolled because they were born on my mother's reservation. But I was born, we grew up in Greenwood. I grew up in a matriarchal family, an extended family. And my life was filled with grandmas and aunties and other mothers and who we called mom. Then there was one man. There's quite a few, but the man who stands out in my mind, my grandfather, Grandpa John Feather, descendant from a leader of the Yanktawa, the Yankton Sioux Indians, the white man calls us, the Yanktawa Dakota. He had been a leader there back in the 1800s, and he had been born free. The ancestor was called Feather Necklace. And that's what it meant in Dakota, but my grandpa, it was shortened by the Bureau of Indian Affairs to Feather. And he would take me out for long walks, tell me stories. He would just take me out, period, but a lot of times long walks, he would tell me stories that had no endings. Now understand, I was 4 years old. And yet, I would think that he didn't like me because he wouldn't tell me the end of the story. And I'd say, but how does it end? How does it end? And he wouldn't say anything. He said, well, you know, that's for you to decide. What I didn't realize until I was much older was that he was teaching me how to analyze and how to draw my own conclusions. What a great storyteller he was.
So, did you draw a lot of conclusions?
I learned a lot. I learned to be analytical, I'll tell you that.
Made you think, huh?
Oh, yeah. I started learning how to use my brain a long time ago.
Yeah. So those kind of grandparents are kind of far and few between today.
Well...
So you were blessed?
That is true. I was born at the right time, back in the 30s. And a lot of our old people who had been born free, or if they hadn't been born free, like my grandpa, born to parents and grandparents who had been born free. I have to understand, because they have a different mindset, a different outlook on life. And they have peace of mind. The most important virtue of the human race is peace of mind. Where in this society do you hear everyone say, I want you to grow up to have peace of mind? What child is told that? You know? That's all. I want you to grow up to be a peace of mind. And then you build a society that creates peace of mind. So that's where they came from. And that's who were my first teachers. It was beautiful.
Today, their kids are taught to go out and make money. You know, and that's about basically it. You start out in chapter one with that, hope I pronounce it correctly, Tayaspe?
Tioshpai. Well, the Tioshpai was another word for clan. We had the clan system. The one thing so-called patriarchs world, they call it a civilization. Excuse me. I don't call it a civilization. I call it a damned way of life. Because the clan system is instant conflict resolution.
I like that.
Instant conflict,
resolution.
It prevents incest at every level of society. And it engenders peace of mind, harmony, so that one is never threatened. The language is developed so that it is a non-threatening language. And in fact, it's very peaceful, peace-loving language. For instance, you call me a warrior. In all the indigenous languages I've had in contact around the world, but specifically in the Western Hemisphere, not one of them do we have the word war or warrior. That's a white man fabrication. He loves war, so when, you know, there's that old saying, you point a finger at somebody, you gotta watch out because three are pointing back. And the patriarch loves to point the finger. Loves to point the finger. And so if he is calling you, and you know this from your own experience with the media, is that when he paints you as being a deceptive prostitute and advantage taker and corrupt, he's pointing the finger. So he pointed the finger at us because he doesn't understand peace. And everybody has to be like him, otherwise he has no control.
I got the idea that one of the beauties of your raising was there was correction by people in your families to each other. No one got away with anything.
Well, let me say this.
Is that what you're saying?
In our system, when the old people were still alive, back in the 30s and that kind of thing, you raise children by never saying the word no. Now try to imagine raising a child up to 5 years of age, 5 or 6, by never saying no. So you don't know what the word, we don't have that word in our language, the word no. It is quite a feat to do it in this modern day world. It can't be done. Oh, it could be if you have enough love and peace of mind. The Teochpa understand the clan system. You know, we follow the woman because the woman lives longer than us, can endure more pain, has more stamina. It just stands to reason we would follow the woman. Also, in our way of life, we don't name anyone after anyone that we know who is living. You have the right to be an individual, and you have the right to your own name. So if you're brought up without the word no in our clan system, and you are told constantly and addressed constantly as the center of the universe, each child is the center of the universe. When a child enters a room, conversation stops. When a child says something, conversation stops. Everybody listens to the child. First 5 years of your life, you're the center of the universe. Everybody listens to you. Everybody acknowledges your presence. Wow. What a way to development, huh?
A lot of security there. In California, you lived in Vallejo.
Right.
Los Angeles, San Francisco. You did accounting. You were a dance instructor, and you did so many other kinds of jobs to survive. Now you have a doctorate in American Indian Humanities and are a senior law partner in the Red Cloud Law Firm. And I know you have several names mentioned in your book here. I'd like to give you another name. Man Who Does Everything. Would you like to share about those years in California?
Oh, glorious years, man. That's what my mother taught me, what freedom means. The only requisite my mother required, and she meant every second of it, is that we had to be home for supper on time. Even if we were playing baseball game or any kind of game. We, especially me, I had to be at home on time for supper. Other than that, the world was ours, man. All we had to do was be responsible. And that's what we learned. Because the very first axiom of freedom is you are free to be responsible. Free to be responsible. And I had my younger brother Dace with me. We went everywhere. We lived on the outskirts of a small town in Vallejo, California. So it was rural setting. We could go out where the sheep were, where the cattle were, where the trees were, where the prairies were, the hills, the sea. We lived by across from Mare Island, a submarine base. So they had that estuary there where the subs would come in. And they had this other strait, the Carquinez Straits, they call it, where the ships and ferries and ocean liners. We played out on those seas. In that bay, you know, it's all saltwater port. We made our own rafts. We made our own tree houses. We did everything.
Your father was one of the first activists to try to regain Alcatraz back.
1964. He and two others and a lot of other Indian people, along with the news media and our lawyers, we went out. A little less than a year after Alcatraz had been abandoned by the federal government, except they still had a warden there, living there, in an abandoned prison, and some, you know, maintenance people. But we went to take it over, based upon our treaty right that we could appropriate unappropriated government land. And at the time, they didn't know what to do with Alcatraz Island, so we wanted to put a university there.
Sounds like a good idea. So there's anything, I guess not, nothing's really happened. I mean, they
have still a prison.
They're still a prison.
Glorified prison. People, and this is what kills me, people pay money to take boats out there, then they pay money to get them on the island to see a prison, an abandoned prison. What kind of society?
Bad karma, man.
What kind of society? I mean, just think about it. Oh, where are you going today? I'm flying out to San Francisco. I'm going to go see an old abandoned prison.
Where people suffered and died and lost their dreams.
Just like they did with the extermination camps in Europe. I don't get it. Yeah.
They turned, in Santa Fe, they turned this beiful spiral staircase that was built maybe by some supernatural spirit figure that walked in to build it. Did you ever see it in Santa Fe? The stairway that was in Sisters of St. Joseph prayed for somebody to come in.
I've seen it in the newspaper because there's a
and built it.
Religious trek there.
That doesn't have a nail in it. It's just perfectly beautiful. And the wood is not indigenous to the area. Anyway, the priest in the area, the scuttlebutt is that Joseph himself came in and built the doggone thing and then left and didn't ask for any pay. Anyway, it is marvelous. I've seen it. I was there. And
Joe, the carpenter who taught Jesus to be a carpenter, right?
Yeah. They made a tourist attraction out of it now. Charge money for people to go see it. In part two of your book, The Making of a Militant, that's 1964 to 1973, there's a chapter about the Trail of Broken Treaties. Would you like to talk about that time in your life?
Well, 64 to 73 was a time of confusion for me. I didn't know where I was going, what I was supposed to do. I knew what my mother wanted me to do. I knew what society wanted me to do. I knew what I was supposed to do. But I was still confused. I didn't know this. I didn't realize this until I did my autobiography. But I always thought the years of my 20s were party years. And I always said those were my don't give a damn years. Then I started doing my autobiography and I found out, hey, I worked my way through 4 years of college during that time. It took me 10 years to do it, but I did it. That's pretty good. Hey, I'm a pretty good guy. And then I made it out of college, became an accountant, went on relocation. The Bureau of Indian Affairs had 7 cities that had quotas on. And we ostensibly told by the Bureau of Indian Affairs, choose a city. But if their quota was filled, they shipped us to the place where they needed to put it, Indians. It was the forced diaspora of American Indians, which is very, very, very effective. The first diaspora was forced marching during winter all those Indians to Oklahoma back in the 1800s, force marching them during winter. Pregnant women, women with little babies, old people, the whole 9 yards. A lot of people died in those trails of tears. So they had another trail of tears. Started under Eisenhower, called relocation. And so ostensibly, we were supposed to choose 1 of 7 cities. But anyway, wherever you went to, I went to Cleveland. Ended up in Cleveland on relocation. Just think, there's Indian people out there, no longer Indians, still living out there. When I say no longer Indians, they have no connection to the land anymore. You know? And we don't have connection to the land. When you don't have connection to the land, you don't have a future. So at any rate, I met AIM. Kind of ironically, I guess is the word I'm looking for. My first experience with AIM is I was against him. It was a National Urban Indian Conference. I was in Cleveland. Wanted to start and started the Cleveland American Indian Center, because there wasn't any services for Indian people in the city of Cleveland. And we were from all over the United States and Canada, Indian people. And when they took us and relocated us to the other cities, they would put us out into all the ghettos and barrios, you know? In the poor neighborhoods, of the white people. So, you know, we were just scattered. So wherever we lived, our children were picked on because they were the loner, you know. So it was a horrible experience, but we were trying to get a Cleveland American Indian Center and went to that Urban Indian Conference in San Francisco. And there I met AIM. And I gave a speech supporting the organization, the National Urban Indian Organization they were trying to destroy. Well, true to AIM's forte, they destroyed that organization. They ended up. And they destroyed it in the way it should be destroyed. A non-functioning bourgeois organization that has stated goals, but they do something else. You know, typical patriarchal type of operation. So that went by the wayside. And so I went back to Cleveland. And also I get a call, phone call from Dennis Banks. Now, Dennis Banks must have saw something in me. And he was mature enough not to be dysfunctional and take umbrage that I was opposing. Because, you know, I had just opposed. I didn't oppose him, but I supported the structure he was, because they had helped us. And I'm not going to try to dispose of anybody that helped me. And us Indian people in Cleveland. So, at any rate, he calls me and he said, the National Council of Churches is having a triennial convention in Detroit. And he said, would you come up there to support us? What? Huh? Well, what's it all about? He said, well, the churches, it started in Minnesota, you know, they come out with some very racist books. We challenged them. And now we want to challenge the National Council of Churches because they raise millions of dollars every year in our name and we never see the money. Okay. I'll go. And I was an accountant at the time. Now I flew up there, flew from Cleveland to a 20-minute flight to Detroit. And it's like I'm going back that evening. You know, I'm going up there to support them. And so I have my tie on, my suit. Flying, and here comes AIM, man, and they're all together. And one thing that impressed me, of course, they all had headbands and vests and Indian power buttons and jeans on, you know. And you're all dressed to the nines.
Yeah.
And they had that that booklet they were putting out explaining who they are. And on the front they had Chief Seattle's famous axiom when he said, let me be a free man. Free to travel, free to stop.
Chief Joseph.
Yeah, Chief Joseph. And at any rate, they had that on there. But what impressed me was they had their arguments together. They had a Lutheran priest with them, or a Lutheran minister, who was high up in the Lutheran synod. I don't know what they have, three synods, one of the synods. And Paul, his name is Paul, I forgot his last name. And they had a lawyer. So they had backup. They know what they're talking about. They were prepared. Impress me. We go in. They take over the podium. You know, there's 4,000 Christians there. And they hold that podium for 4 days. Prior to that, the black movement had put a list of demands on the Christian churches. Well, we put a list of challenges. We didn't put any demands on them. We didn't ask for reparations. We didn't ask for anything. We put challenges. If you're going to raise money in our name, then you have to create within your own church an organization that will receive the money. It'll be peopled by, the majority have to be Indian. The chairperson of that organization who oversees the money has to be an Indian, or else it has to all be all Indian. And then you can disperse it among only your Indian people in your denomination. They accepted the challenges. About over a dozen denominations created what they called Indian desks within their church. And sure enough, that's what they did. They start separating out of the money. For at least a decade, Christian Indians received millions of dollars in grants for their local churches, for their local youth programs, for whatever. Okay? We never got a thank you. We never got a thank you. And no one writes up about it. That's because we were classified as militant, because we were not afraid to speak out. And in those days, that's what a militant was. They think the Patriot Act is bad now? They think you can't speak out now? If you spoke out then, you were treated as a militant, not as an activist, not as a protester. You were a militant. And if you're an Indian, how dare you get up off the sidewalk? How dare you throw away your potteries and start speaking up for your rights? You're an Indian. Get back to the reservation. You know? That was the exciting times. And when I saw that here's some Indian people, the first generation of the diaspora, they knew exactly what was happening to them. And I knew exactly what was happening to us. They're killing us. We weren't going to be Indians anymore. We didn't have a neighborhood. Nothing. We were being picked on. So, when they stood up, that's when I joined AIM. And then the best part was when we sat down together and we said, and it was at the Hotel Leamington in Minneapolis in 1970, spring of 1970. And we said, who are we? What are we? Why are we? And where are we going? And the conclusion was, I think there's just seven of us in the room. Let's go home. Go home to the elders, because we still had those people who had been raised under people who were born free, you know, who hadn't gone to school, who couldn't speak English. We still had those people who were alive. So let's go back and learn from them. So we did so.
Hey, you. Hey, Indian. Who are you? You come from the earth. You are the moon. You are the wind. You are the season. Who are you? You gave the zero. You gave the food. You gave the gold. You gave the flesh. Hey, you. Hey, Indian. Who are you? They took your dignity. They took your freedom. They took your land. They think they took your future. Who are you?